Welcome to a Heritage Regina presentation, Boom, Bust, and Bullets, the history of the General Motors plant in Regina. Hi, I'm Dale Edward Johnson, an award-winning automotive journalist and author. I've written more than 1,200 columns about cars for newspapers, magazines, radio, and the internet, including CAA Magazine, CBC Radio, Collectible Automobile, Old Autos, and the Toronto Star. My book is about a rare Canadian car, and it's called The Last Best Car, the 67X. Did you know they used to make cars in Regina, Saskatchewan? For a time, it looked like Regina might become Oshawa West or Detroit West. I want to share with you those dreams, what happened to them, and why. To tell you about Regina's General Motors plant, first I want to set the scene. So, please join me. Let's travel back in time to the boom in Saskatchewan during the 1920s. Saskatchewan was a very different place in the 1920s than it is now in the 2020s. Saskatchewan was very prosperous. People had lots of money to spend. This was the third most populated province, behind only Ontario and Quebec. And cars, well, as the 1920s opened, there were 61,000 motor vehicles in Saskatchewan. That was one for every 12 residents. That was the highest ownership rate in all of Canada. Saskatchewan was growing. Regina was the capital city of this booming province and the largest city. Regina was already home to the RCMP, Regina College, and the provincial legislature. Canada's very first licensed air harbor, or airport as we now call them, opened in Regina in the 1920s. It was on an open prairie near the corner of today's Hill Avenue and Cameron Street. Regina became a distribution and manufacturing center for the province. People had lots of money. Saskatchewan was very different than just a decade or two earlier. The 1920s saw a growing middle class, thanks to higher wages, more jobs, more consumer products, easier credit, and more leisure time. People had the time and money to take in the latest movie, or travel by airplane, or listen to the radio, or just relax at home. The sales of cars increased dramatically during the 1920s. More dealers were needed to sell these vehicles. Saskatchewan ranks second, behind only Ontario, in the number of automobiles owned. More than half the cars on Saskatchewan's roads were Ford Model Ts. But people who went car shopping in Regina in the 1920s didn't have to settle for a Model T. They had lots of other choices. People could buy Plymouths or Dodges or Chryslers at Gray Campbell. It was in a building used today by Vintage Vinyl on 11th Avenue. Or DeSoto's at Bothwell Motors at Albert and Victoria. Or Studebaker's or Stars at the Saskatchewan Motor Company. Or Graham Page's at Masterton Motors. Or Chevrolet's or Oakland's at Regina Chevrolet Sales, where the Cornwall Center now is. In the late 1920s, the number of car dealerships in Regina totaled 16. Today, there are 17. As well as the dealerships to sell vehicles, there were more spin-off industries. There were repair shops, tire stores, and gas stations. As Regina historian Bill Brennan puts it in his book, Regina, An Illustrated History, the automobile broadened the base of Regina's economy and enhanced its role as a distribution center. So, that's a look at Regina during the Roaring Twenties. Now I want to tell you about one of the 40,000 residents of Regina in the late 1920s. His name was James Henry Dillon. He came here seeking a better life. Dillon was born in Ireland in 1893. When he was a teenager, he and his brother wanted to come to North America. They had an uncle in Minnesota, so they moved there in 1912, and they got jobs in a hat factory their uncle owned. But Jimmy Dillon quickly found out he didn't like working in a factory, so he quit his job and went back home to Ireland. But then he realized he didn't really want to stay in Ireland, so he moved to Canada and settled in Regina, Saskatchewan. He liked all things mechanical, especially automobiles. He landed a job at Spears Funeral Chapel, looking after the vehicles. When the First World War broke out, Dillon signed up and joined the Royal Canadian Naval Reserve. He was in Halifax, Nova Scotia in December 1917. That's when a Norwegian ship collided with a French cargo ship loaded with explosives. The Halifax explosion was the largest man-made explosion at the time. It left about 2,000 people dead and another 9,000 injured. As well, more than 10,000 buildings were destroyed or badly damaged. Jimmy Dillon ended up with a scar from ear to ear on his chin. He also lost about $700, which in 1917 was a lot of money. It would be like losing about $18,000 today. After the war, Dillon was given a homestead in Saskatchewan between Moose Jaw and Gravelburg. But the land was poor. Jimmy Dillon soon gave up on trying to be a farmer. He moved back to Regina in the 1920s. He got a job as a mechanic at the Ambrose Thompson Garage. That's on Albert Street, just south of 14th. He was in Regina during Regina's boomtown. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm very pleased that joining us tonight, right here, is that time traveler, Jimmy Dillon. So let's welcome this time traveler. Hello, Jimmy. Now, you lived in Regina during the 1920s when it was a real boomtown, like 1927, the Hotel Saskatchewan was built. You saw that go up. 1928, new airport was built. Regina has passenger and mail service by air. So you've really seen this city really boom.
Speaking about booming, you should see the housing that's going up around this city. Why, there's whole neighborhoods being built up by the legislature. And if you go down east, you're going to find there's buildings going in all over. There's houses around Winnipeg Street and all the way up on 4th Avenue. But I'll tell you what the biggest news is. June, General Motors announced that they were opening an assembly plant right here in Regina. It's going to be huge. Why, we're going to be making cars for all across Western Canada. Why, just the other day I read the Morning Leader and it said that there was over 50 factories and warehouses in the city. And that the building permits have exceeded those that happened after the 1912 cyclone. And that was a time when the city was being rebuilt. Well, I'll tell you, things are really booming.
So it sounds like you're pretty settled in this boom town.
Oh, I'm settled and I'm getting more settled. Why, I'm 35 years old and it's about time. The big news for me is I'm getting married in November, November 12th, 28.
Well, congratulations. Tell us more about the bride-to-be.
Her name is Edith Mildred Boyd. Everybody calls her Mildred. Why, she's from Duval, a pretty little town, 55 miles straight north of here. Her father runs the general store, and her mother's a seamstress. Would you like to meet Mildred?
Oh, yeah, that'd be great. So please join me in welcoming another time traveler, Mildred Boyd. So Mildred, congratulations. We've just heard the good news that you're marrying this fine young man next month.
Yes, that's right. Once we're married, I'm going to give up my position as a school teacher so I can stay home and look after my Jimmy, my tall, handsome Irishman. You know, he asked me to marry him 3 times. And the first time he asked me, I thought, well, he was much too old. He's 13 years older than I am, you know. And then a while later, he asked me again, but I said no again.
So you've said no twice?
That's right. You know, I think some girls, they get married too young, but not me. I thought I really wanted to do things like teach. And like I even went up in an airplane ride not that long ago.
Oh, yeah.
It was so amazing to fly like the birds, and not many people have gotten to do that. Some people don't even believe I have, but it's true. A woman that I work with at the school, a teacher, her brother, he has an airplane, and he took me to Moose Jaw one day. And another time, we went to Saskatoon. Anyways, I'm getting carried away with my traveling stories. You asked me about my wedding. Such a special day for any gal. Well, the third time that Jimmy asked me to marry him, I figured I'd better say yes before I became an old spinster school teacher. Jimmy's got a great job. He can fix nearly any car. And you know, he just put a down payment on a nice little house in the new area of Regina over on 4th Avenue in Argyle. And you know, I think one day he'll make a wonderful father. We're so lucky to be in love and to live in Regina in the 1920s.
Well, Thank you, Mildred. Thank you, Jimmy. And thank you for traveling through time to share with us what Regina was like during the boom times of the 1920s. Bye now. Jimmy talked about the new General Motors plant in Regina. The building is still standing today at Winnipeg and 8th. General Motors decided to build the plant in Regina to make cars and trucks for all of Western Canada. In the 1920s, GM Canada was less than a decade old when it was already outgrowing its manufacturing facilities in Oshawa, Ontario. GM opened an engine plant in Walkerville, now part of Windsor, Ontario. And then GM spent months looking at various locations for a plant in Western Canada. It was front page news on June 1, 1928, when GM decided to build its new plant in Regina. It was the largest plant in the city with 330,000 square feet, or about 30,000 square meters, and there were jobs for 850 people. GM selected Regina for several reasons. First, it was centrally located for the Western Canadian marketplace. Regina-made cars would be shipped to the four Western provinces under the slogan, Western Made for Western Trade. Also, sales of GM products were high in Saskatchewan. Another reason? GM said there would be a source of labor, specifically farmers idle during the winter. GM purchased 38 acres of land from the city of Regina at $1,000 per acre in the northeastern section of the city, north of 8th Avenue and west of Winnipeg Street. The president of GM Canada, Sam McLaughlin, traveled from Oshawa to Regina to finalize the agreement with city officials. The Morning Leader newspaper reported,
"It was a big day. Regina had secured its first big industrial plant. And it was big news. Biggest news since the war," declared one alderman. "Biggest since the cyclone," exclaimed another. And it was big news, the most constructive announcement made in years.
McLaughlin told the newspaper,
"The West has always supported General Motors in splendid fashion."
He also said he was optimistic about the prospects for the future growth of Western Canada. And he said GM was demonstrating that optimism in
the very practical form of a decision to spend $1 million on this Regina plant in anticipation of an ever-increasing market throughout the West for Canadian-built automobiles. This in itself is the greatest tribute that could be paid to the growing purchasing power of the territory.
Then there was a ceremony where McLaughlin turned the sod for the start of the work on the plant. The Morning Leader reported,
"Mr. McLaughlin was handed a spade and with a vigorous push of his foot sent the implement deep into the earth, turning over quite a generous amount of earth. After chatting a few moments, the party entered their cars and drove to the train depot."
Construction work lasted through the summer of 28. There were jobs for lots of people. Many of the senior staff were transferred from Oshawa to Regina to run the new plant. On Tuesday, December 11, 1928, the new plant officially opened. There were jobs for 850 people at a time that Regina had about 40,000 people. With a population today of more than 200,000, the impact would be like a plant today with about 4,300 jobs. There was a 24-page supplement to the Morning Leader on December 11, 1928, with the title, "Welcome, General Motors." The section opened by calling the GM plant
"the most important announcement for Reginans since the war. The announcement meant a giant industry for Regina. It meant the employment of 850 workers. It meant the coming of other industries and other workers. Since that time, a dozen new industries have located in Regina. The year has been one of unusual importance to Regina, and important development hinges on the coming of General Motors."
The section included articles about the construction of the plant, how the cars will be manufactured, and the state of the auto industry in Canada. There were also dozens of congratulatory ads from Regina businesses, like this one from the Duncan Motor Company, the Pontiac dealer. It was on Albert Street, just south of Victoria, where Credit Union Central now stands. There's also mention that Saskatchewan has more than 115,000 vehicles, and about 7,000 new cars were being added to Saskatchewan roads each year. That meant about 20 cars were sold every day in Saskatchewan. The late 1920s were indeed booming and prosperous times in Saskatchewan. With production getting underway, GM President Sam McLaughlin came back to Regina for the official opening in December 1928. More than 1,000 Regina residents turned out for the event. They saw Sam McLaughlin drive the first car off the assembly line. It was a Chevrolet, and it was presented as a gift to the Regina Red Cross. This Chevrolet was also unique because it was powered by the first six-cylinder Chev engine manufactured in Canada at GM's plant in Windsor. This car was later put on display at Modern Motors, one of two Chevrolet dealerships in Regina. Modern Motors ran newspaper ads to promote that it would have that very first Regina-made Chev on display. The ad said,
"Through the courtesy of the Canadian Red Cross Society at Regina, we have secured for display purposes the first new six-cylinder Chevrolet assembled in Regina, powered by the first motor entirely made in Canada. This new Chevrolet was presented to the Red Cross by Mr. R.S. McLaughlin, President of General Motors of Canada Limited, and it will be on display in our showrooms during the next few days. It is the first car assembled in Regina. It is the first of the new Chevrolet Sixes assembled in Canada. It is powered by the first motor entirely made in Canada. It's better because it's Canadian. See it on display in our showrooms."
Later in the day, there was a civic parade through downtown Regina. Then there was a reception at the Hotel Saskatchewan at 4 p.m. It was hosted by the City of Regina. All citizens were invited to come and meet Sam McLaughlin and other officials of GM. An editorial in the newspaper said,
"The coming of the General Motors plant has already worked something of a transformation in the city's life. It has quickened trade and industry generally. It has quickened the community's whole life. There's a new spirit in the air, a note of buoyancy and optimism on a scale greater than before."
Shortly after arriving in Regina for the grand opening, McLaughlin told the morning leader that the plant demonstrated the optimism GM has in the healthy financial condition of the West, and added,
"Although the plant is located in Regina, we feel it will benefit the West as a whole, particularly in turning the eyes of Eastern manufacturers towards the industrial possibilities of the West, as well as the distribution of hundreds of thousands of dollars in wages and in better service to the purchaser of cars. Because many of our cars are driven away, it was important to have the plant as close as possible to the center of the territory."
An ad by General Motors of Canada mentioned head office and factories, Oshawa, Ontario, factories at Regina and Walkerville. It also said, "Regina has become Western Canada's motor city." The Regina plant was expected to produce about 30,000 vehicles each year. The Regina-made vehicles were different in some ways from those made in Oshawa. For example, Regina-made 1929 Chevrolets had spoked wheels, while the Oshawa versions had solid wheels. The GM plant had a tremendous ripple effect. For example, related businesses to make glass, paint, and batteries built plants near the GM plant. GM also constructed a posh new dealership in downtown Regina at Rose and 12th to show off its new products. It made good marketing sense to have the biggest and fanciest car dealership in the city where the products were being produced, and that red brick building is still standing today. Regina business people opened new shops and restaurants along Winnipeg Street near the GM plant. Houses and apartments were built for workers, including the Frontenac apartments on Lawrence Street just south of Victoria. The city of Regina had more money coming in as the GM plant paid for water, taxes, and power. Lots of people had more money to spend, and the city and province had more taxpayers. When the Regina Pats won the Memorial Cup as junior hockey champions of Canada in the spring of 1930, the city of Regina presented coach Al Ritchie with a brand new Chevrolet sedan, one that was manufactured in Regina and purchased from Regina Chevrolet sales. So the GM plant, in a way, capped off a tremendous decade of growth in Regina. But the good times didn't last very long. the boom soon went bust.
Life is bare, gloom and misery everywhere, stormy weather.
The Regina plant was opened for less than a year when the stock market crashed in October 1929. Then came the drought, devastating the crops in Saskatchewan. Car sales dropped off dramatically. With the Saskatchewan economy in shambles, GM laid off some of its workers in early 1930. By August 1930, production was halted. In March 1931, the plant reopened, but was shut down a few months later. As well as the assembly line employees out of work, so too were people in related industries and the neighboring stores and restaurants. Over the next few years, the economy gradually showed signs of improving. In 1937, GM decided to reopen the Regina plant. However, the plant needed extensive refurbishing. Production methods had changed dramatically. GM spent about $700,000 getting the plant ready to run again. When the plant reopened in December 1937, there were jobs for 400 people. That was less than half the number when it first opened. Priority was given to those who had been working at the plant when it closed in 1931. Six supervisors who had been with GM in Regina previously were brought back when the plant reopened, including some from GM at Oshawa. The vice president and general manager of General Motors of Canada, Harry J. Carmichael of Oshawa, traveled to Regina for the grand reopening ceremony in January 1938. In his address at a community reception at the Hotel Saskatchewan, Carmichael talked about the importance of corporate Canada helping out those areas that had been hardest hit by the Depression. He said,
"Our company, in spending over $700,000 in rehabilitating and reopening our Regina operations, is not guided by the necessity for production facilities, but by a belief, right or wrong, that it is in the economic national welfare that we extend a helping hand to the Western provinces in their greatest time of need."
Public tours of the refurbished plant were held. By the way, the first car off the assembly line after the plant reopened was the Chevrolet on the left. It was a gift to the Red Cross, just like the first car made at the Regina plant in 1928, shown on the right. An estimated 6,500 people turned out to tour the facility when it reopened.
One of the people who landed a job at the GM plant when it reopened in 1938 was Jimmy Dillon. To find out more what that plant was like then, let's welcome back that time traveler, Jimmy Dillon. Hey, Jimmy, do you remember this picture of you working on the GM assembly line?
Oh, yeah. I remember one of the guys came to work with his brand new Kodak Brownie and snapped a few pictures. I guess I should have turned around on the picture for a smile. But I'll tell you what, we're sure glad to be working in this plant. I'm glad to be there. I'm very lucky, actually. You know, when the GM plant reopened, they had a company policy that former employees were hired first. And then it was married men who were on assistance, and I never was on assistance. Then it was single men on assistance. And then finally, they opened it for the general public, and I got hired. And I'm sure glad I did.
Well, yeah, Jimmy, a lot of people didn't have any work during the Depression. So how did you make out before this job at the GM plant?
Well, it was really bad. Never imagined life could have been that tough. Our little daughter, Elsie, was born in 1931. And you know what? Our family was luckier than most. We had our family together. We had a house that we were just able to keep by renting out the basement. And you know, I always managed to find a little bit of work. But it was tough.
But you had lots of experience as an auto mechanic.
That's right. I worked for Thompson Garage for 10 years. But you know what? They had to get rid of us in 1930. There was no money to fix cars. There was no money for gas for a lot of people. A lot of people just parked their cars. Or you know what some did? They took the engines out of the cars and they hitched up horses and they used the cars that way. They called them Bennett buggies. You know, our Prime Minister Bennett in Ottawa, I don't think he realized how tough we were having it out here out west. So I think some people felt we were a bit abandoned.
So what did you do when you lost your job then?
Well, a couple of buddies of mine started the Ray Street Garage. At first it wasn't too bad, but you know what? Money started getting short, and there just wasn't enough for three families, so we had to close her down.
So then, did you get another job?
Well, I knew a guy at the Traveler's Garage up on Albert and Vic, but you know what? He shut after a year.
Wow, so what happened then?
Well, you know what? I needed money for to put food on the table, and there was a job rum running. Yeah, you drive down to Moose Jaw and pick up rum and then drive it down to Chicago. I'll tell you, I made some pretty good money there, but Prohibition ended, and that was in 1931 in the United States, and, well, that was the end of that.
So I see now why you were so glad to land that job at the GM plant.
Well, I got a job at Regina Auto Body on Angus, but they ran into some problems, and they had to get rid of me. And the next year, I went over to Hohner Auto Body at Albert and Vic. I was glad for the work, but each job paid a little bit less. I was actually down to $4 a week. Well, you can barely keep a family fed on that.
Well, I see now why you were so glad to land this job at the GM plant.
The best part, I'm earning $24.20 a week.
Wow, and I understand that's a huge change. I understand that's because of the union, the United Auto Workers. They had a sit-down strike in Flint, and then that really changed the auto industry where most people were unionized. And those new contracts also covered workers in the Canadian plants in Oshawa and Windsor and right here in Regina.
And I'll tell you what, we're building new Buicks, Chevs, Olds, Pontiacs. We're also doing trucks, Chev and Maple Leaf trucks right here. You know, I didn't like much working at my uncle's hat factory in Minnesota. But things are different now. I've got a family, I'm making money, and instead of hats, I'm making cars. Hey, I got to get to work.
Okay, well, Jimmy, thanks for joining us and telling us what the GM plant was like in the 30s.
When the GM plant reopened, the Leader Post said,
"Located in the center of the populated area of the Prairie West, Regina is ideally situated as a distribution point for the products of General Motors. Western points, which had formerly had to wait for shipment of new model cars from the Oshawa plant, will now receive them with less delay, with delivery from Regina."
As the jobs returned, life was getting better in Regina in the late 1930s. Certainly not as good as the 1920s, but far better than the early 30s. But everything was about to change. The war clouds forming in Europe in the late 1930s soon were felt everywhere, including Regina. The Regina GM plant was closed for a second time in 1941. It was taken over by the federal government and renamed Regina Industries Limited. After the boom of the 20s and the bust of the 30s, now the GM plant was turning out munitions in the early 40s. So, how did Jimmy Dillon make out during the Second World War? Well, he didn't serve this time because he was in his late 40s. He had already left GM when it was converted to a munitions plant. Dillon had landed a job as a mechanic servicing grain elevators with Saskatchewan Pool Elevators, the forerunner of the Saskatchewan Wheat Pool, now Viterra. That's when real job stability began for him. The Dillon family added a son, Jim, in 1940. The family moved into a larger home in 1956 at 1110 Elphinstone Street.
Dillon stayed at the Wheat Pool for almost 20 years. He retired in 1958. Now, to catch up on what's been happening, let's welcome back a time traveler from several decades ago, Mildred Dillon. By the way, Jimmy Dillon died of a heart attack at the age of 69 in 1962. Hello, Mildred.
That was a long time ago. More than 40 years ago, since my Jimmy died. He died in the summer of 62. That was when the doctors were on strike. How could the doctors be on strike? My Jimmy liked working at the Wheat Pool. He'd drive around southern Saskatchewan fixing grain elevators. It was about that time that we had our second child, Jim, in 1940. Elsie was 9 then. She was such a wonderful big sister. I'm so thankful for my tall, handsome Irishman and my 2 lovely children.
And Mildred, tell us about your kids. First, your daughter, the eldest, Elsie.
Elsie married and moved to BC just after her dad died. She had 2 children, Patricia and Chuck. They're the only 2 grandchildren I have. I love my grandchildren. They're so special. My granddaughter, Patricia, worked in that big Cornwall center in the 1980s. And when she'd get to talking with her customers, they'd tell her how they knew her grandpa. And they would say, "Grandpa fixed my car." But you know, Grandpa might have even built their car. My Jimmy.
And how about your son, Jim?
Jim went to university in Vancouver. He got a law degree. He worked all over. He worked in Vancouver, Ottawa, and Calgary. He even worked in the Middle East. That's where he met that nice Noella. And they got married.
And what are they up to these days?
Well, Jim is retired with Noella in Australia.
Ah, well, thank you very much for sharing those stories with us, Mildred. By the way, Mildred Dillon died at the age of 96 in 2003.
After the war ended and there was a return to the peacetime economy, a lot of people in Regina were hoping that GM would reopen their plant. They wanted Regina to again be Western Canada's Motor City and turn out Buicks, Chevrolets, Oldsmobiles, and Pontiacs, as well as Chevrolet and Maple Leaf trucks for all of Western Canada. But it never happened. Automobile production techniques and distribution methods had changed dramatically from the time the plant opened in 1928. It simply no longer made sense to build vehicles in Regina for the 4 Western provinces. When the government offered the plant back to GM, the automaker turned down the offer. The federal government turned it over to the Department of National Defense. It was used as a supply depot, then taken over by the provincial government, and later sold to private interests. It's been subdivided into offices. Regina's big dreams of becoming Oshawa West came crashing down when the Depression hit, and then ended for good after the Second World War. Over the years, GM has also had plants in Windsor, right across the river from Detroit, and in suburbs of Toronto and Montreal, but they've all been shut down. And GM recently stopped production in Oshawa, Ontario, where it had been building cars since 1907. GM still has 2 manufacturing facilities in Canada, both in Ontario, in Ingersoll and St. Catharines. The Regina GM plant is part of a display at the Canadian Automotive Museum in Oshawa. There's even a Regina-made Chevrolet on display. It's part of a larger display about the historical significance of the city of Regina in the Canadian automotive industry. The building that was once home to General Motors in Regina is still standing, and now it's home to a variety of businesses and organizations. It's also a great place for photos of old cars, like this Regina-made 1938 Pontiac owned by Doug Keith. And if you look carefully over the main doors of the building at Winnipeg and 8th, you can still see the signs that it was once a GMC plant. I would like to thank many people and organizations for helping with this presentation. I'd like to make a special thank you to Jimmy Dillon's granddaughter, Pat Newson of Vancouver, and Jimmy Dillon's son, Jim, of Brisbane, Australia. Pat and Jim provided many of the stories, details, and pictures presented, and this story would not have been possible without Pat and Jim.